All right, we'll get going. There may be some stragglers, but we'll get going. For those of you who don't know me, my name is Ian Grant. I'm the director of the Entrepreneurship Center, known as the eCenter. So welcome to the first boot camp of the spring semester, and arguably, with the delay or the cancellation of the kickoff, our first I2 Passport event, so thank you. A couple of housekeeping things. For those of you who have not, if you're interested in registering for I2 Passport and haven't, and you want this event to count, which if you do today and Wednesday is 4,000 Visa credits, it's the largest amount you can earn. You can go on Wildcat Link now, and we'll still count it. But if you register tomorrow, today it won't count. Is that clear? Is anyone here interested in doing that? Okay. Just as a reminder, the student with the most amount of Visa stamps gets $8,000 to pay down student loans or pay for tuition next semester. If you didn't see the announcement, there was originally one $3,500 second prize drawing. That's now been doubled. So you have two chances if you hit 23,100 Visa stamps to be entered into a drawing on May 8th to win $3,500. And then if you're first gen, so first in your family to attend college here at UNH and in UNH, there's a unique $3,500 drawing as well. So really exciting for us. Couple other events. So on Sunday, those of you probably already know this, but one of the opportunities to earn some more Visa stamps is by entering the Holloway competition. So there's information on our site or on Holloway competition at Paul College. And next Tuesday, there's a speaker series. Jay McSherry, who's owns Jumping Jay's big restaurateur, UNH alum, is speaking with another alum. So that's down. Either be at the eCenter or probably here. You can register for that. The other thing to update you on is that, as you know, last Sunday, Jeff Hoffman couldn't speak as the kickoff. I spoke with him today. We're actually trying to arrange a date in April. So that will be rescheduled and that will be announced as well. Amazing speaker, really terrific guy. A couple students, some who are here, actually were able to have at least brunch with him last week. So not to be missed, but more information on that. And so what's really neat about this bootcamp amongst all the others is that it all starts with ideas. And so Dev Dutta, who's from the Paul College, an entrepreneur, amazing professor, all around good guy actually, is gonna take it from here and we'll go from there. If anyone has not swiped in, you have to swipe in, just make sure you do on your way out. Dev,
okay. Thank you, Ian. Thank you so much for that kind introduction. Everybody can hear me? Okay, thank you so much for coming. It's Monday evening. You must have had a long day, beginning of the week, and yet you are here. That just, to me, tells me that you all are very interested in idea generation, idea creation, possibly on the topic of creativity, innovation, entrepreneurship. Now, entrepreneurship, it might seem it's more closely aligned with business, but that's not really true. There are entrepreneurs who have had academic specialization in multiple fields. And it's just the passion and the idea that led them onto a path of entrepreneurship. So you all are potential entrepreneurs, and maybe some of you are even current entrepreneurs, or at least entrepreneurial in the way you think and you do things. So I commend you for that. This two-day boot camp is going to be more on going from the idea through the process of creativity and innovation into coming up with ideas for venture creation. So it's a long journey. We will try to compress it in just 2-hour blocks over 2 days, today and this evening and Wednesday evening. Obviously, it's going to be quite jam-packed with a lot of stuff. If you have questions after today or after the Wednesday session, please feel free to get in touch with me. We can talk more if you have something more specific to discuss on these topics. But it's going to be just a very, very brief introduction over 2 days, very fast paced. And hopefully after that, some of you might be motivated, depending on, if you're a Paul College student, then you possibly could be doing the entrepreneurial studies option. But if you're a non-Paul student, I don't know if you know, but we have the minor in entrepreneurship available to all UNH students. So some of you might potentially consider that. I'm the faculty director for the minor program in entrepreneurship. So again, I'd be very happy to talk to you about any aspect of that now or in future. All right, everyone all set on today's topic? We are going to start with let me ask you with a question. First topic that we will cover is about creativity, and then we'll move on to innovation, and then finally towards entrepreneurial idea generation. So my first question, or I have two questions for you. The first one is, how many folks here think that you are creative? And I know I'm kind of putting you in the spot, you know, who would want to say that, oh, I'm not creative? Or who, hopefully all of us would say that, yes, we've had creative moments. So folks who feel that they are creative, could you please raise your hands? Okay, a number of them. Folks who have not raised their hands, is it that you think you're not creative, or is it that you might ponder on this question a little more? Any thoughts on that? Do we have anyone here who thinks he or she is not creative? Okay. All right. We will see very soon. So we're going to start with the game right now. If you know the process of this game, please just play along. You know, don't blurt out the correct way of playing this game. But what I'd like everybody to do, and I was discussing this with Yen, that is it possible to do it? But I think we have enough space here, so we can do this. What I'd like you to do is, nobody's going to talk to each other at all. It's going to be all in silence. But in silence, everybody in the room, all the attendees, that is, all the participants, you're going to arrange yourself in a single line here. Folks who have birthdays of 1st January will be here. Someone who has 5th January might be right here. 10th January, April, all the way up to December. You cannot talk to each other. Can you please play this game right now? We will debrief this exercise very soon, but first let's give everybody a big hand. Okay, you may now go back to your seat. So we'll discuss very briefly on this exercise and then we will move on with our topic. How was it? Did you all enjoy the game? Was it fun?
It was really fun.
Okay, I'm glad to hear that. I could see you know, the rule was you couldn't talk to each other, right? But then pretty soon you found out different ways of communicating. So I'd just like to focus a bit on how many different ways did you communicate so as to be able to form this very neat line of people, almost correct to the point, you know, a minor adjustment here or there, but otherwise everybody lined up just the way I had requested you to do. And isn't that amazing? It's really wonderful that some of you might be buddies here, but many of you probably are meeting each other for the first time. And then this is the first few minutes of this boot camp, and yet you very quickly worked out amongst yourselves very effective and efficient rules in order to be able to do this job at hand. If that's not creative, then what is? So I'd like to know from you, what are these techniques or strategies that you applied? I did see some folks, you know, writing on the phone, maybe on the notes or something and showing. I noticed that, so that's one strategy. Could somebody else tell me what other strategies you adopted? Go ahead.
How we like wrote it on our hands.
On your hands, yes, absolutely. Any other folks also followed that? Some of you did that? Excellent, very effective. Go ahead.
Body language.
Body language, yeah, wonderful. So that's amazing and highly creative, appropriate to the situation at hand, right? So you're very creative. What else did other folks apply? Anyone else wants to add? Oh, go ahead, I see so many hands up. So please tell me, what did you do?
Number of the months on the hands.
Okay. So first sorted out based on month, right? And then the day was, it's like a kind of a two-stage process. Excellent. Anybody else wants to say something? Go ahead.
Phone.
Sorry?
Phone,
absolutely. I mean, who wouldn't want to use the phone? The phone is such an essential tool that we all have these days, right? So very, very, you know, appropriately used. What else did anybody else do? Anything else apart from these? So we already came up with 4 or 5 strategies and they're very effective. Any other strategies? Okay, so that is what creativity is really about. Being in the situation, understanding what you need to do, and then being able to work out a very effective way of solving a problem. Now, this is different from also, creativity can come in different ways. Another way would be to get a spark of a thought, not really having a problem at hand, but then still being able to, you know, come up with a brilliant idea, and then being like a light bulb going off, and then thinking about it, and then introducing something new, even though you were not in a situation where you needed to solve a problem. So there are multiple ways of looking at creativity and working out creativity for ourselves. And we practice it all the time. All of us do. So we all have that high, very high potential of being creative people. And yet though, in life, if you look at it, some people are more, turn out to be more creative than others, or are rated to be, or are told, you know, society calls them more creative, like Einstein, for instance, or Thomas Edison. Thomas Edison, the scientist, about whom we will discuss a little more during our second day session, he holds the record for over 1,000 patents, you know, and be the phonograph, which was the original, the record, and then it was transformed into the CD or the cassettes and CD. All the music industry is based on his work. Likewise, electricity, the General Electric Corporation was a company that was created by him. So he holds the record even today of more than 1,000 patents. So he is certainly one of the most creative persons ever. Now, do we have the potential to be like that? Can we? Well, it all depends on how we look at the world around us and try to solve problems. Maybe some of us have the potential to be like him. So it is only up to us. It's only limited by our imagination. But before we move on, so I had brought up another game. And this is a little more specific. The first one was more like a warm-up exercise. And just to get everybody kind of familiar and comfortable, because we are here for 2 hours, we want to be able to interact with each other and learn from each other. This is a little more specific. So I have sheets of paper for it, or some of you may have paper as well. So if the instructions are given right there. And I'd like you to work in small groups for this. So think of an idea. You haven't thought about this before. This is something, the instructions you're getting right now. So think of an idea. It can be a solution to a problem, or it will help make life better, or it can become the basis of a new entrepreneurial organization in due time. So I'm looking at, I know this room is not the best arrangement for sitting around a table kind of and working on a problem jointly, but we'll make the most of the situation, we'll do with the situation that we have. And that's also about creativity, trying to work out solutions in the process, in the context that we are placed in right now. And it might be conducive to creative work, or it might not be very conducive, and yet we have to do the best we can and do it within a time limit. So just read those instructions, break into teams of 5 to 7. I had said 5 to 7. We can also do it depending on how closely we are aligned, in terms of seating arrangement, 4 or 5 would also be fine. So the first part, you're thinking of an idea. The moment you've thought about an idea, probably every individual will think of an idea, or maybe you will start talking right away and come up with just one idea. You have to choose one idea in your small group. Finally, you have to choose one idea. It could be a solution to a problem. It could help to make life better for people in general, or it can become the basis of an entrepreneurial idea or an entrepreneurial organization. So the first part, you as a group, select that idea, come up with it and select it. And then in the second part of the exercise, you have to actually identify those 4 C's, the characteristics of the idea, what are the intrinsic features of that idea, the characters, people who will be involved in order to take the idea to fruition. That is one of the most important parts of creativity. We can have a lot of ideas in our mind, but if you don't do anything more with that, it's not really completing the full creative cycle. We have to complete the full creative cycle. So we get so many ideas every day. I'm sure everyone gets lots of ideas. Some of those ideas just stay nascent and kind of fall off the cliff, as it were. They don't go any further at all. A few more ideas, we might take a little forward. And some ideas really become the spark of creating an enterprise. So obviously in 2 hours, we will not be able to do all of that. But I'm kind of just laying out the process for you. So come up with the idea and then identify these 4 aspects of the idea, the characteristics of the idea, the characters, people who will be supporting it or who will be involved in it to take it forward, components, what are the specific parts? So if you're thinking about a new app, to do something very different with just with everybody's cell phones. What might be the parts or specifications? What things would be the features of the product you would have in that app? And lastly, what would be the challenges in implementing this idea? So even though it seems like a very big problem right now to come up with an idea and identify those four C's, it should not take very long. This is supposed to be a quick game again. So we will have about 3 minutes for idea generation, and then maybe another 5 minutes for coming up with the four C's. Obviously, it's not going to be the best way of doing it right now. We could have spent 2 hours on this, but our point here is to be able to think on our feet and see what ideas we come up with. I'm really eager to know from you, like, what was the idea that you came up with, and how did you identify the four C's? So please form yourselves into groups. You can turn around, or you can just stand in a place. 4 to 5 to 6 people, whatever number you like, and go ahead with the problem solving. Okay, I think time is up, so please settle down, and I'm going to be calling out teams. And one spokesperson from each team is going to come and report on their idea. First, let's give everybody a big hand for working on this idea. Now, who would like to go first? Which team would like to come here? Two things I want from each team. Tell us very briefly about your idea, and then just run through the four C's. Tell us that the characteristics are this, the characters who will be operating with this idea would be these people, or likely these people. These are the exact features that we would like to have in this idea. And then the challenges. What might stand in the way of taking that idea towards fruition? So any volunteer team to come first? Go ahead.
Okay, hi everyone. So our idea is to create an app that will virtually allow you to stand in line at bars in like the college area. I know that the lines tend to get long very quickly, so this app would allow you to check in online and then notify you when it's your turn to go in, and then you have 5 to 8 minutes to arrive, and if you don't show up, it'll just automatically go to the next person in line. So, yeah.
Do you want to briefly tell us about the four C's?
I mean, the characteristics she already said on her presentation, okay. But for the characters, people will be involved. The bouncers have to be honest, because they're gonna be the one counting the people to go in. The owners of the establishment have to be on it, because it's their establishment and they can make a profit from it without noticing. And also people that code need it to make the app viable.
Yes.
And
yes.
We need a headquarters too, to make like our private servers viable too.
What's the components?
Well, I think you only need a phone and the app for the components.
Pretty easily. And the challenges?
The walk-ins will be a challenge because we cannot account for them because they don't have the app. But if everybody uses the app, it kind of loses some of the sense of the app, because you want to be like the VIP, you know, you want to be like above everybody else going into the club. And accounting for people, because we cannot install like a system in every bar that we're going to cover. That will be another issue.
Excellent. What do you folks think about this idea? Let's give them a big hand. Excellent. I've seen those lines, so I know that this is desperately needed, this app. So maybe some of you will, I know Ian, you all offer a summer seed grant for taking projects forward and creating entrepreneurial organizations. Maybe at the end of today's session here, some of these teams might even apply for that grant, and we can see whether it goes forward from there. But thank you so much for being the volunteer, the first team to come up, and secondly, doing such an awesome job. Who would like to come next? Please come.
Hi, everyone. So our idea is an app which will be like a mediator between students who want to exchange books between themselves. So they won't have to rent it or buy it from Amazon or bookstore, which is even more expensive. And it would be a nonprofit, which would just charge a delivery fee and make sure everyone delivers a proper book to a proper place and no one fools anyone.
So I would like to go through the four things. Characteristics, my friend already told you about it. And the characters, people involved are mostly the students all over the states. And first we want to just within the states show the shipping is not a big problem. And it can also be professors or other faculty members or whoever wants are interested in exchanging their books with someone else. The components are just application, it will also be have a website and you just need a phone. The main challenges we will face are Amazon or Craigslist, because Amazon provides rent books and they are pretty cheap than just buying it or used one. So in this one, we can sell out our product by saying that you only pay the shipping, nothing else, and the book stays with you forever. And once you're done with that book, you can always exchange it again with someone else or like, and it keeps on going. It's like a cycle of books. And in this way, we also like reuse and recycle the book, which also helps our environment to become more and more greener. So thank you so much.
Excellent. And I think the great feature of this idea is that, you know, it's just the potential buyers or users versus the people who want to give away the books. So you're cutting out a lot of people in between who charge part of the money that you pay for, you know, for
yes,
me.
Yes, like whenever our semester gets over, there are always people on campus or in Durham downtown as well who buys the books. But I always have noticed that they pay extremely less money, and I don't even want to give out the books for so less, rather than I would just give it to someone else who may use it for their upcoming semester. So it's better I just exchange it with someone for the book I want from other students across the country.
Thank you, great idea. Let's give them a big hand. Okay, so we move on to our next team. Who would like to come next? Please, yeah. Thank you.
All right, so we came up with a product that helps with cars and snow, so who doesn't like waking up in the morning and having to shovel off their car? It's a pain, right? So our product will, you'd be able to spray on the chemical at night, and the chemical would then mix with the snow to melt off your car, so your car would be snow-free in the morning.
So that's practically the characteristics of it. Characters, you know, we need like chemists. We kind of want to like introduce like graduate students to do research to actually lower the cost and make it the product more affordable, because that's going to be one of our challenges is actually like making the product like less expensive to the actual general public. And other things that we want to make sure that that it doesn't ruin paint, because you know like there's not a lot of research into this yet, and we want to make sure that it's eco-friendly, because you know like any chemicals can be definitely detrimental to environment. So.
Okay, excellent. So I think. You know, if this idea really takes off, it can be very big. You know, we've recently experienced the snow here, right? And I'm sure all of us were affected in some way or the other. I think among the challenges, you rightly pointed out that it would need maybe approval from federal agencies and others. So if we are able to go through that process, this could be very useful for areas that get a lot of snow. So let's give our team a big hand.
So we came up with an idea where it's a restaurant that is inside a garage. So you can drive up and get your car fixed. And the whole idea is that when you stay in the car and then it lifts you up, and then on the second floor is like a gourmet restaurant, so that you can just, you can have your meal and you can watch your car getting fixed. So the characteristics, pretty much it. Characters, we need really good mechanics, because you're going to be able to see them. Restaurant staff, back of house, front of house, a management team. You'd need kitchen equipment, food suppliers, and probably a really good marketing team, since it's kind of a crazy idea. And then the difficulty would be pretty high, because there's probably a lot of health and safety mixing those two things. And then the timing that it would take to fix your car might be longer than you could eat. And we'd have problems with coming up with auto-themed puns for the title of the restaurant. And then zoning laws and noise from the shop.
Okay, excellent. Let's give this team a big hand. So I think, we really got a great idea here. You know, it's very unusual, and some of these ideas that really take off in a big way tend to be unusual. We will cover more of this in the next day. But I think amongst the characteristics, one of the things could be that something that makes this idea unique, I think one of the things would be that that you can get your car fixed and also have a gourmet meal at the same time. So combining two rather unusual activities into one, saving time. The other thing could also be just the fun of it, you know, that the car right goes right up and leaves you at the restaurant, and then when it's ready, it again comes up and you just get down into the car right away, you know, and that some folks might like that experience. So I think those would be the things that we would want to tease out from ideas like that. What is the unique thing that makes it so valuable? And we'll talk more about it in the after tomorrow session. But let's go on with our next team. Who would like to come? Okay, this team here.
Sure, so the idea that we came up with was kind of taking a look and re-engineering how tutoring is done and have it exist solely as one-on-one video conferencing that can be very specific for certain units within a subject, for a subject overall where you could stay with the same tutor, or just for several minutes at a time for something quick that you don't understand.
Yeah. So for characteristics, basically it'd obviously be an application on your phone or any computer that has a camera. Characters, people who need tutoring, and then on the other end of the spectrum, people who want a tutor. So some components, so obviously, like you said, you need a phone, you need an application, but the main part of it is that it eliminates people having to meet with tutors at like a mutual time, mutual place, and it doesn't limit you to the area that you live in. So, you know, if there's a place that's specifically good at tutoring different things, it'd be easier for you to get tutoring for that. Challenges would just be like the general tutoring. A lot of people, you know, are not really technologically advanced, so some people might be skeptical about using it. And then, you know, there's not really other many companies that do that. There's like online tutoring and stuff like that, but there's no video like interface tutoring.
Excellent. So, you know, as I'm kind of hearing these ideas, I'm really liking them because you all are covering the whole spectrum, going from the bar and issues, you know, in trying to get in and find a space, to all the way to tutoring and then learning and concentrating on your studies. So, coming from your student background, you've already identified a range of problems across these teams, and you're trying to come up with innovative solutions to that. So I really like it. It's very wonderful, I think. So let's give this team a big hand. Which team? I saw more hands go up. Chris and team.
So the basic idea for our company is just a messaging system for a phone that translates into another language whenever you send through. So if someone on the other end, say, speaks French, I speak English, maybe a little broken French, not enough to talk with them, I can just type in English, it'll translate immediately into French, and that's basically it.
Wonderful. So would you want to briefly touch upon the four C's?
Yeah, I'll go about it. Yeah. Okay, so we have some characters. So some of the characters we feel is the communication with more people. So what we're trying to do is beat a language barrier. And so if someone wants to go and talk, say he's going to Spain, speaks English, doesn't speak Spanish, he can talk to that culture and talk to people and interact with their friends. The characters, obviously, we want to attract millennials who travel, but basically anyone who has this language barrier. And then components, we simply need a translator, and then artificial intelligence and a couple other things with the engineers as well. And then challenges we see would be the structure of languages. So different languages have structure their sentences differently. And then also, of course, slang words, but which we're going to use artificial intelligence to outsmart slang words and the structure of our language.
Excellent. So I think this is, again, like, you know, going with the trend of travel and globalization and people wanting to communicate with people from other cultures. So I think it's a great idea. Let's give this team a big hand, too. Okay, who would like to go next? Okay.
Okay, so our idea is kind of a website that is basically a marketer or a promoter of startup companies. So it's a website for the people who are curious of really new and innovative products and services, but maybe don't know where to find them if they don't kind of come across them just reading in articles. This would be a website where you could search for that. So some characteristics would be, it is a website. It would be a really search-friendly platform for people to use and navigate. Lots of links and posts by these startups, and almost kind of like a customizable view of what the startups would want you to see.
So like in order to connect the startups business and people, we will have the platform to list all of the startup company, and we may face the challenges. How can we attract all the startup company and put the link in our website? So like, because of this problem, we need to think about how can we attract them. But if we want to attract them, we supposed to like kickstarted, like helping them to invest or giving them a mentor. We need to offer a lot of benefit for them in order to attract them. However, we also need to attract the user. Although we have a lot soft company list in here, so like maybe some people were curious and use their product or services, and then when they use their service or buy their product, they can give the review just like why do we go to the restaurant, and then how does it look like, if we work on it, it's possible to go on it.
Excellent. I think, you know, all of us would be interested in an innovative website like that, which tells us about new things that are coming in or happening. So let's give this team a big hand. I think the wonderful thing that this team also talked about, and I'm sure the other teams have thought about it as well, is that, you know, you have to, in terms of the characters, you have to look at multiple entities or different stakeholders. So they talked about getting startup companies interested to provide information for this website, but at the same time for users, getting users connected, and the needs might be different and the motivations would be different. So trying to get multiple streams of people to visit this website. So I think that's a very important insight that came out explicitly from this team. So I commend you for that. And we will talk more about it in Wednesday's session. So how many more teams do we have left? Okay, so one team there, another team here. Who'd like to go first?
So how many of you guys have gone food shopping before? So how many of you don't like doing it? All right, well, anyway, the thing we came up with is kind of an app that allows you to pick a grocery store, kind of hopefully set it as your location, and then either scan while you're there or preset the items you want to buy so you can, it's kind of more of a budgeting app. And it'll allow you to kind of keep track of your total as you're going along so you don't overspend and you can stay on budget. It'll help out with your time management. And then if you want to get really fancy with it, you can maybe combine it, get like a partnership with Tasty. And if you want to make a recipe with them, you download the ingredients, it finds it in the store for you, and then lists out how much it's going to cost. And if you want to get extra super fancy, you can link it up with MyFitnessPal, and it'll tell you the most nutritious items and some cool things you can make out of that. As far as the four C's go, the challenges are probably going to be obviously user adoption and the maintenance of the app, so making sure that it's always updated with the different stores as well as the different, you know, price changes in the items. The components, you're going to need the app scanner. I guess the app scanner, the iPhone app, and just the map of the store. For people, it can be used for all people, the consumers. You're going to need a lot of app developers, marketing and sales, user education, adoption consultants, things of that nature. And I think that's it.
Wonderful. I'd love to have that app. You know, I mean, grocery shopping is a kind of a chore, you know, and if we can have something like that, that would be wonderful. Especially, I really like the idea that you can go from regular to fancy to super fancy, you know. I've heard about the first part. Other teams have talked about this in my class, but linking it to nutrition information and all that, I think that's a great idea. So let's give this team a big hand. And last but not the least, our final team of the day.
So our idea was essentially a text by GPS location app. So you're leaving home, you're coming to school, and you just hit a button, and this app will automatically send a text to your parents or whoever saying, hey, I got there, I'm good to go, or something like that. So onto the four C's. For characteristics, I just described those. For characters, mainly software engineers and maybe some focus groups to help nail down what the interface will look like. For components, computers, software for coding, and testing applications. And some of the challenges would be funding, testing, and marketing.
Excellent. Let's give this team a big hand, too. So you all have done some great work. And now in the second part of today's session, we are going to move into a little more of the, you know, the concepts and things like that. But before we do that, I think we can reward ourselves with a short, very short break. OK, I think we are going to get started. I know some folks might still be outside and would be coming in maybe in a minute or two, but we just want to keep going. So the 4C game that you all played, you know, with a very strong focus on idea generation and then looking at different aspects of the idea, and everybody, all teams did so well on that. The first part, I don't think we need to talk more because you already came and presented that. The second part, what are your key takeaways, lessons learned about the process? So in the first, before the break, we talked about the content of those ideas or what you came up with. In this few minutes now, we would like to talk about the process because, again, you all just came together as a group. Maybe you know each other from before. Maybe some of you just met here for the first time. And yet you worked cohesively together and came up with an idea and felt confident to present it right here, you know, in front of an audience. So, and you did very well on that. So I'd like to just listen to you about the key takeaways. How was the process of, you know, brainstorming to come up with an idea and then staying focused in terms of about 7 minutes of time that we had and being ready to present it? Anyone wants to share any lessons learned on that? What worked, what did not work? Or what worked very well, what could have worked better? Anybody, just one idea, go ahead.
I think the biggest thing is working in like a group because, well, actually what happened to us is we had like four of us came up with an idea and then one person was like, oh, we can actually do this, which is the same product. So like getting different perspectives is key because if we didn't have that person, then we would have gone up with an idea that's already been made.
That is so important. So being able to, you know, sort of suspend judgment and take in multiple perspectives in the beginning of that. And then, so it sort of is like very broad-based in the beginning, mixing together of different thoughts, perspectives, and then being able to channelize it and, you know, and working with a deadline or with a deliverable idea and then coming up with, and then staying focused. So thank you for sharing that. That's very important. Anybody else wants to share any other lessons learned from this process of 4C? What worked very well? What could have worked better? Go ahead.
I guess just committing to an idea, you know, whatever it is, just go and go through all the steps.
Going through the steps. So it's sort of like a process that, okay, we have a task to do, spend a few minutes brainstorming and free flowing of thoughts, and then start to sort of, you know, go through this checklist of the 4 C's. So following a process. Thank you so much for that. Anybody else wants to share any lessons learned from that Greek game that we played about the process? Anyone? Go ahead.
I think it kind of just shows that like there are a lot of ideas out there that people may have not like capitalized on because like in a lot of them they came up, I think most of the ideas we came up were original.
Yes.
So it shows there's like still a lot more like to make out there.
You know, that is such an important point, and I really want to thank you for bringing that up. I would like to emphasize that there are hundreds and thousands of ideas floating around, things that people have not tapped into yet that are just waiting to be tapped. Of course, is that going to lead to a successful entrepreneurial venture? That we cannot say right away. But if we did not even come up, you know, seize an idea, how would we even go towards creating an entrepreneurial venture? So the first thing is about looking out around you, brainstorming, you know, understanding what people have, what people like, what people would like to have, and then trying to crystallize all this and come up with some idea potentially for a successful business. And then, of course, you run through different stages to see if it would, you know, if you can really take it forward, would you have some people to back you in terms of financing and things like that? But that's such an important point. There, you know, all kinds of ideas are available, are just waiting to be tapped. We just have to stay a little more aware and look around more, maybe, and you know, we will be able to get those ideas out. And we may have to look at different ideas, and the first few may not be all that viable in terms of creating a business, but some might. So we have to focus more on that. But all of that starts with the process of, you know, knowing oneself. So we'd like to spend a little more time on what defines creativity, what creative people, what are the characteristics of more very highly creative people, something about the nature of the creative process. So a few definitions and a little bit of concepts here. Let's just focus on the first definition, creativity. The ability to find new solutions to a problem or new modes of expression by generating an idea that is of value to some people. So I put the key phrase in italics. It has to be of value to some people. Otherwise, the idea is not going to go forward. It might still be a great idea, but you know, it won't help us to launch a business or launch an organization. So as hundreds of ideas go through our minds on a day-to-day basis, and some stay with us and some just fall off the cliff, those that stay with us, if we really want to pursue them further, we have to think that, okay, why would this be valuable for somebody? Why? We have to be able to find an answer to that question. We might not be able to find it right away. We may have to talk to our buddies or people in the dorm or somewhere else, you know, and say that if I came up with something like this, would you want to use it? Would this be valuable for you? Would it help to improve your life in some way? If people generally say that, yeah, this is worth trying, I mean, we'd love to have something like this, then you know that you are probably onto something. So it has to be of value. It has to be a new solution. It has to be a solution to a problem. Or if you're talking about writing and, you know, creative art and painting and things like that, it would be a new mode of expression. In a class that we took up this topic very briefly, folks asked me about, you know, that what about painters who just paint a picture or a sculptor who, you know, makes a sculpture? They are not trying to solve a problem. They're just giving expression to their creativity. But the point is, there are people in the world who'd like to see wonderful paintings. You know, they might visit a gallery and be able to buy it or go to an exhibition and see it. So there is some value to other people that these folks are creating. Maybe they did not think deliberately about creating a business or something like that, but they still came up with an expression of creativity which turned out to be valuable for other people. And we have to keep that in mind. Otherwise, creative ideas may not necessarily be the basis of a business. And our idea here is to get you into more of entrepreneurial mode of thinking. So keeping that value to some people and trying to find an answer to that question, I think is very important. So the creative process, lots of research has been done on the creative process. And this people have, you know, tried to come up with models and then tested it with inputs from users and seen that, is it really this? Does it really follow this set of steps? And there have been variations, I mean, but still, Guilford, he came up with this process in 1950 based on research, and it has been verified quite a few times. Of course, with some variation here and there, but it seems like in general, the creative process has got four stages. The first stage is preparation. Like what you all did today, you know, come up with an idea that is of value to someone, solve somebody's problem. You thought a lot about that. So in general, if we are trying to create ideas or come up with ideas that could be the potential for entrepreneurship, then we have to have some level of preparation in the beginning. And the preparation doesn't mean that we, you know, lock ourselves in a room and start thinking. We just have to be more aware of our surroundings and be very mindful of what people talk about their day-to-day problems or things that could make their life better but don't exist as yet. We just have to keep our eyes and ears open to that. And when we hear something like that, if it strikes us, it has to strike a chord in you too. I mean, you have to feel enthused about it. But if you did, then you should think a little more on that. So that's the second stage, incubation. So after we've identified a problem or thought a lot about the problem and done whatever preparation we could, we have to leave it to, you know, to the subconscious mind to take over. And that's something very important. At some stage, to let go of it. We've done the most that we could in terms of problem solving or idea generation. Now we need to let it incubate for a while. Incubating means detaching ourselves from that and then letting our very powerful subconscious mind take over. All the people who came up with lots and lots of creative ideas, like Thomas Edison, for instance, he explicitly talks about it. Many centuries before that, Leonardo da Vinci, who's again, you know, a prolific genius in right from engineering to math to writing to sculpture to painting, so many fields he was involved in. He explicitly wrote about this when people asked him that, how are you, how can you be so creative? How do you manage this? He said, I just do my preparation and then let the divine or the subconscious, whatever you call it, take over. So that's the incubation period. After you've let the idea incubate and, you know, just be there submerged in the subconscious, you might get an illumination, which is called like a flash. And it's not necessary that all ideas will lead to a flash like that. Some ideas may not proceed further from there. You left it to the subconscious, but nothing happened after that. That's possible, but it is possible that you might get an illumination. And then you just need to then, the moment you get that, there are stories of people, you know, waking up in the middle of the night and then jotting down their thoughts before it kind of, you know, got erased from their memory, because next morning they don't remember. There are lots of writers and lots of scientists who have talked about this, waking up in the middle of the night, getting the flash, and then jotting it down right away. And then later on, you would need to verify it. You would have to play out the next few steps to see that, is it really, you know, is it something concrete that can be taken forward? Or is it that, you know, it's way ahead of its time? Ideas can be way ahead of their time, and they may not be the wherewithal available for us to take it forward. There could be ideas like that. So I just have two quotations about the creative process, and I'd like you to read this very carefully. I mean, it might seem the second one is very long, but I think there's a lot of information in that, something that talks really about the process. So it's just quietly read the first thing, quotation, and then read the second one. Everybody got a chance to read both quotes? So the first one for me, and you know, you can think for yourself, it is possible that you might get the same sense as I did from these two quotes, or it could be that you got some additional insights, which is would also be very valuable. But for me, the first one, it seems like, you know, he's a very famous physicist, and he said that some of it is effortless, it just happens. So there is, you know, we cannot push creativity. It has to happen on its own at some level. We can try and do the preparation for it, but after that, it just could take off on its own. And we have to be aware to those possibilities, and we have to seize the moment if it happens. The second thing for me is more specific, the second quote. You know, the key words there, extracting yourself from your comfort zone. So we all love to be in a comfortable zone which goes well with our current lifestyle and, you know, gets us settled and follows a routine and it's a schedule that we are used to. All that is great. It helps us to be efficient and do our day's everyday work. But then in order for creativity to come by, we have to at some stage extract ourselves from the comfort zone. And even if it's discomforting for us, we have to be able to do that. We have to be willing to fail. So we have to get rid of any fear that what if this creative idea doesn't lead to anywhere? If we did not even, you know, try to go on that path, we would not even know whether it would be leading us to success or to failure. So we have to try. Having a healthy disregard for the impossible, I think that's a very key phrase. So, you know, we don't, if an idea comes and it seems very weird or wacky, we just don't dismiss it right away. We have to think, you know, how is it that I got this idea? Maybe there's some potential in it. maybe it may sound very counterintuitive right now, but maybe that's what is going to make the difference. So being very, you know, open to the idea of, even if it seems impossible, it could take off, who knows? Seizing every opportunity to be fabulous. We want to be fabulous. We have to try and be that in our own ways. It will bring chaos into our lives if we go on the path to creativity. A lot of times it is going to be uncomfortable for us. A lot of times we will be, after putting in effort, we will find that it's not leading anywhere. But that's the nature of the process. If we did not even go in that route, then we will have a reasonably, ordered life, pretty satisfying, I think. But we may not be able to generate something very highly creative. And we have to have the confidence that problems can be solved. Any questions or thoughts on these two quotes? Anything additional that you want to point out beyond what I've stated? So, some insights about creativity. Children, we all know, and we've all, you know, gone through the stages of being a child or a baby and then child and then teenager, so we know that. We tend to lose this ability to be creative somehow. As life gets more ordered, we have to follow structured processes. We have to follow rules because we are part of society. We are in the school or in the college, and there's set way of doing things. We tend to lose this. So the idea is to be in the processes or in the situations that we are in and be able to lead that structured lifestyle and yet be childlike in terms of coming up with ideas or playing with or being playful with ideas. You know, we are expected to be serious and proper, conform and be productive. All that's great, but it helps, in a way, it kind of blunts our creative edge. So the challenge then really is how to be in a society or in an institution or in an environment where we have to follow structured rules and yet at the same time be able to stay somewhat detached and be playful and, you know, welcome the some of the, you know, non-conformist ideas. If we can manage that, I think there's chances that we will be highly creative. In fact, look at this last point here, the research. Frontal lobes of the brain that engage in creative thinking are literally turned off during creative endeavors. You know, so in the beginning, there's a kind of a turning off of those lobes that happen. And then it sort of takes off from there. So balancing and being structured as well as unstructured at the same time, I think that's really important. I already talked about the unconscious mind, and too much conformity with status quo and following the beaten track kills creativity. So the question is then is how to foster creativity? Firstly, we begin with the premise that everybody is creative. We are all naturally creative. We've all gone through our childhood stage when we were most creative. Somehow we lost that edge for some of us. So can we regenerate that? Can we come back to it? How can we do that? So we'll talk more about that. We cannot force creativity though at the same time. And just being wacky will not help generate creativity. So it's a very delicate balance of structure versus not structure. I already talked about this, being playful and purposeful, conscious problem solving. We have to talk about, you know, what's the value for folks here? How can we be in tune with our unconscious mind? This is very hard to practice. It's not easy. And we don't get trained on this. Whoever has told you that we have to be in touch with our unconscious mind and that, you know, we have to delve into it, let it incubate, we don't get formal training on that. We are good at things that we are trained to do. And some of the stuff that you are very good at doing, being an athlete or, you know, being a player in a baseball team or being a math wizard, you've had years of practice on that. So is it any wonder that you do very well in those? Have we really had even days of training on being creative and then being practicing creativity in a very mindful way? Maybe not. So the chances are that our creativity is just latent, waiting to be explored. And we have to find a path for ourselves. Whatever works for me may not work for you. The broad contours would be the same, but within that, we have to find a path for ourselves. So we need a strategy to be creative then. Let's talk about Leonardo da Vinci. As you know, he was born during, he lived during the Renaissance period in Europe. Look at his, you know, his, the domains that he involved in and left a lot of wonderful work that is praised or admired, or people are just, you know, like absolutely surprised by the creative energy and the output of the individual. So he was a painter, a sculptor, an architect, an engineer, a scientist, a mathematician, a musician, a writer, and the list goes on. He unraveled the sciences, introduced new art techniques. People say that balancing the sciences and art is so different at the same time for the same person. We, some of us are naturally more focused towards the sciences, some more towards the art. But he was able to combine both and be very prolific in both. He was one of the first persons to dissect a human body. And those days, you know, people had no knowledge of that illnesses or diseases were could be solved within the human body. Most people thought that those were divine interventions, like depending on what things you did or you did not do, you know, some people had to suffer through illnesses and all that. But he said, no, let's look at the human body and see, you know, how, what is it composed of? What are the parts in it? Why do some parts don't function that well? Why do people fall ill? And he actually dissected a human body to get that. So he had that innate curiosity to be able to do so. And maybe he applied it all the time, this curiosity, and he was able to harness it. So he had a very highly imaginative mind and an unquenchable curiosity. So he wrote, he kept a journal of what is it that, you know, helped him to be highly creative. And it's amazing that those journals are still available in, you know, in his... they've been preserved and they're available for people to read. But he talked about these seven principles, and they are called the Da Vincian principles. The first one is curiosity. So if today's session, you wanted to kind of, you know, what would be the key takeaways for us, lessons learned from Leonardo da Vinci, we should make a note of just these seven items, you know. And then work out a strategy for ourselves, for myself, based on these seven strategies. How can I practice each one of these seven things more and more? Curiosity. Demonstration, a commitment to... The first one is obvious, I think, so I'm not going to talk, and we've already talked about that quite a bit. Demonstration, a commitment to test knowledge through experience, persistence, and a willingness to learn from mistakes. So he was not thinking in the vacuum. He was not saying that, oh, let's just give a free flow to my imagination and I'm on a kind of a trip and that's it. And at the end of it, it's more like a dream and I come back to reality. Not at all. Everything that he came up with, he wanted to test it out. And he wanted to practice it and see if it works or not. So I think that's the second very important thing. Having the idea, but being able to take it forward. And I already said that if you have to take it forward, you know, think about why is it going to be valuable and value for whom? And is that a significant number of people? If it is, then you have a potential in that idea. Sensation, the continual refinement of the senses, especially sight, as the means to enliven an experience. So very, being very sensitive. And there are some questions that I have for each one of these in the subsequent slides. So you can answer these for yourself and see how sensitive you are, or how curious you are, or how much of a demonstration do you do on a day-to-day basis. Smoke, that's very interesting. Becoming open to the unknown, a willingness to embrace ambiguity, paradox, and uncertainty. So these are, you know, somewhat complicated words. So I'd just like to spend a minute on them. Anyone knows what's an ambiguity or an ambiguous situation? When I say that, you know, it's very highly ambiguous, or I don't like ambiguity, what do I mean by that? Randomness, you know, something that's neither here nor there. I don't have a clear-cut pathway. It could turn out to be like this or the other, and I'm kind of uncomfortable. Our natural instinct is to be like that because we have got, you know, it from our ancestors. They had to survive in very hostile circumstances. So, you know, you had to run away from ambiguity or ambiguous situation. But the point is, creativity is fostered or thrives in ambiguous situations. So we've got to kind of regenerate it and bring it back to us, even in a very structured, comfortable existence that we are in today compared to our ancestors. Paradox, two things that seem to be you know, totally contradictory and yet both are possible, a paradoxical situation, and uncertainty, randomness, not knowing what's going to happen next. art and the sciences. He talked about, imagine, you know, so many hundreds of years back, he talked about whole brain thinking, that we have to use the entire brain. And much later, people started talking about the left brain and the right brain. And that theory has also been kind of now, you know, debunked. So whatever we knew earlier about left brain thinking and right brain thinking, and one sponsors more of the arts and the other one more of the sciences, that's been disproven so far. But what is important is to be able to utilize our whole brain and be naturally inclined not just towards the sciences, but also the art, the body. I think this is so important. The cultivation of grace, ambidexterity, fitness, and poise. So he was talking about being very fit in the body if you have to be fit in the mind and have to come up with creativity. And I know that all of you, if not most of you, if not all of you, have a fitness regimen and you do some exercise or, you know, run or do something or the other. So you're already on that path. You are taking care of the body. So the mind can only happen after that. And hopefully it is just waiting to be tapped. The last one, the connection, a recognition of and appreciation for the interconnectedness of all things, or systems thinking, as he called it then. That it's a whole and we are a part of that, and things are all interlinked in some ways in this world or in the across the entire universe. When we start thinking in broad views like that with system thinking, a lot of things that would have bypassed us otherwise and not become apparent to us become apparent. So we have to engage in systems mode of thinking. And, you know, I'm not going to let you do this because it's going to take a lot of time, but you can quickly run through these questions and see for yourself how curious you are. If you answer yes to almost all these questions, then you are a naturally curious person, which is the first of the Da Vincian principles. So I'll just pause for a minute and let you go over these, and you don't have to answer them. Even if you did, it would be just for yourself. You can add the scores and see how highly you score in curiosity, but do you do most of these things, or all of these, or none of these? Then you know where you stand in terms of your innate ability to be curious. Everyone had time to go through this? Okay, so let's move on to the second one. Demonstration. How well do we practice and take in new experiences in addition to being curious? So just run through these statements and see if you agree with most of them, if they work for you. You know, you can do a quick run through. So if you answered yes to all, you can just add up. That would be your score. If you did yes to some but no to the others, you can put plus one, minus one, and get some score. So you know for yourself how high you score on the second Da Vincian principle of demonstration. Any questions so far? Now, this one, I don't know if it's visible to folks at the back, but, you know, I had to put everything on one slide. This is sensation, having the high sensitivity to our external environment. And they classify it in terms of our five senses. And then the synthesis, the last one. So I just put three of these. You know, there are more questions or more statements under each. But again, you can quickly run through. I know the color of all my friends' eyes. Do you? I mean, I don't. I was just trying to read that statement. I really don't. And I thought that, oh, I never thought about this, you know? I have friends, I always look at them when I talk to them, but I never really notice that so-and-so has green eyes, so-and-so has blue eyes, so-and-so has brown eyes, and they are different. I didn't. That means in terms of sensation to the external environment, at least in terms of the vision, I'm scoring pretty low on that, based on that first statement. I'm sensitive to subtle changes in lighting. Are we? Are you? I found for myself recently I've started to be a little more sensitive. Like I can, when I'm outside or when I'm waking up in the morning, my bedroom window faces the east, and the sun rises, and I do notice some difference in the colors of the sunrise from one day to the other. So I've started to be a little more sensitive to the changes in the light. Maybe that's helpful for me in terms of being sensitive to the external environment. Look at the smell, the second one. I can reliably judge the quality of food or wine by its aroma. Can we do that? Not judging just the aroma itself, but the quality of the food, depending on the aroma. That is quite a complex skill, I think. But if you're able to do that, then in terms of sensation to the external world, we are highly sensitive. I can taste the freshness of fresh food. We all love fresh food, but have we ever tasted the freshness inherent in the fresh food as different from the distinct from the taste of the food itself or fruits, you know, whatever it is? Tasting the freshness of an apple versus the taste of the apple itself. Are we good on this one? Can we move on to the next? So the smoke one. I think the last one is really interesting. All of these are interesting, but the last one especially so. I can comfortably hold contradictory ideas in my mind. Our entire educational system pushes us to go for the best solution, the most optimal solution. So in such a process, it would be hard to hold on to contradictory ideas. We would have to throw out contradictory ideas and go towards whichever one seems to be most relevant for us or most helpful for us or most effective for us. But then that would be detrimental to the creative pursuit. In creativity, we have to be able to hold on to contradictory ideas and be able to somehow reconcile them in our mind. You know, ultimately, we have to go towards a solution from the creative process. But if we push this is the best and nothing else is going to work too early, then we will possibly miss out on the most creative solution. So we have to be able to juggle this contradiction for a while. And then after that, ultimately, when we want to take the idea forward, we have to choose whatever seemed to us the best option after much thinking and much jugglery, but not too early. Now, this art and science, so I just try to put them side by side. And if we're high on one, we tend to be low on the other. But creativity requires us to be, equally balanced on both. And you can see this for yourself. How many of these do you answer in the affirmative and on both sides? Any questions or any thoughts? This one, about the body, and he always talked about the body first and then the mind. It's important to have a healthy body if we have to be highly creative. That's his idea. Just look at these two, which seem to be, I'm aware of the ways in which my physical state affects my attitudes, and then I'm aware of the ways in which my attitudes affect my physical health. So it's like, the mind and the body connection. He talked about that right then. One affects the other. We know much later, doctors and psychologists and scientists have found that there is an intrinsic connection between the body and the mind, but he kind of experienced it himself and talked about it. And then the systems thinking or the connection. And the last one is, I thought was highly revealing or very interesting. I sometimes experience a sense of connectedness with all creation. And again, it might seem it's very wishy-washy or very philosophical, and does it even happen? Maybe in a meditative state, and that too for some people. But no, not really. I'm sure you have had moments of that when you felt that you are really not detached from the rest of the world. You are a part of that bigger whole, you know? And he felt it. And it's an essential characteristic of highly creative people, if you, you know, if you believe Leonardo da Vinci. And the proof of the pudding is in the eating. He has demonstrated it by all the work he's left behind, that he's highly creative, being able to manage things that are very, you know, unusual, like the in the arts, sciences, medicine, math, everything. So we can rely on what he wrote down in his journal based on his own experience. So what I have now is a very interesting video. I hope it'll be coming up here. Creativity as Sacred, a short video. And this is on YouTube. And I looked at several videos thinking, what could I bring to this session here? And I think this is a very nice way of ending today's session. So let's just hope that it comes up nicely here. And he's a professional actor, consultant, creative person. So he will, you will really like the video, I think.